In Arkansas's Ouachita Mountains, raindrops fall and cascade over the rocks until they reach the valleys below, forming four rippling streams, each possessing its own unique characteristics. The South Fork Stream meanders 38 miles through Garland and Saline counties. The North Fork travels the shortest distance, a course of only 29 miles, wholly within Saline County. Between them are the Middle Fork and the Alum Fork. The Middle Fork is spectacular in springtime, its banks painted with wildflowers of all hues. Along the Alum Fork, cliffs tower above the stream, like soldiers standing guard over nature's precious bounty. The four streams converge near Riverside in Saline County, giving birth to the Saline River, the last free-flowing river in the Ouachita Basin. The river, which is generally a series of pools and fast-flowing shoals, with a bed of gravel, flows 204 miles through seven of Arkansas's counties. Saline, Grant, Dallas, Cleveland, Bradley, Drew, and Ashley. The watershed that feeds the Saline encompasses 3,350 square miles. Amazingly, over the 204-mile stretch of this free-flowing river, only one small waterfall exists, and even then, it only exists during the extreme low water season. The small waterfall is located on the southern portion of the river near Landfair Landing and drops just 3 feet, creating a rare section of rapids on the Saline. An even rarer formation on the Saline River is found miles upriver from the waterfall, just south of the entrance of Hudgeon Creek. Just a few seconds float trip downriver from the creek's mouth, a long stretch of rocks can be seen on the east side of the riverbank, even during some high water times. These rocks are likely an outcropping of Ouachita region stones. Although they are found technically in the West Gulf Coastal Plain, and therefore by definition out of the Ouachita Mountains, they are probably the southeasternmost evidence and the last viewable sign of the Ouachita Mountain region, as the land turns into a more mushy conglomerate of sloughs and marshland. All along the river's southern trail, lignite deposits have been discovered. The largest of these deposits is in Ashley County, in an area once owned by Governor Elias N. Conway, called Goulet Island. The northern section of the river near present-day Benton has long been known for its saltworks. Caddo natives created saltworks along the upper portion of the Saline River well before Spanish explorer Hernando de Soto did the same during the 1540s. Later, during the 1700s, settlers would barter and trade for salt with the Caddo people. The production of salt in Arkansas began to decline and continued its fall until the Civil War. It saw a small boom during the war due to the supply line from outside sources being disrupted. After the war, the salt works diminished once again until they completely ceased to exist. Salt's impact on the river had already been solidified well before the Civil War broke out. The name Saline is in fact derived from a French name for the lower river region of modern Felsenthal, called Maria Saline, which translated from French to English means salt marsh. In 1804, the American exploratory team of Hunter and Dunbar also noted the presence of buffalo salt licks on the lower end of the river and guaranteed the name by placing Saline on their 1820s map of their journey through this land. The Saline is a habitat for an array of aquatic creatures. One of the largest animals to call the Saline home is the powerful snapping turtle, which can live up to 70 years old and typically feeds on the remains of dead fish and other water-dwelling creatures. The massive turtle grows to a top average of 31.8 inches long and can weigh 180 pounds or more. Their tongues are camouflaged to resemble a worm and can hunt live prey by sitting idly on the river bottom until an unlucky fish takes interest in the bait and perishes by the jaw of this strong snapper, who can cleanly take off even a human finger with one swift bite.
My uncle says he's seen one so big one time he was pushing all the water in front of him, kicking up dust behind him, so that's a pretty good sized turtle. But the biggest one I ever seen weighed about 110 pounds, and Punch Martin caught him on a trot line, I think, or maybe a net, I'm not sure. His biggest loggerhead I ever seen. It was a monster. But that Saline River is eat up with turtles.
From turtles, bugs zipping across the water, topwater minnows, and tadpoles, the river is truly a place filled with life. But for some of these creatures, the Saline is also a dangerous place. The frogs that inhabit the Saline River are uniquely adapted to blend in with their environment. This young frog is barely an inch long, and without paying attention, he goes easily unnoticed. This camouflage is his best defense from birds, lizards, and snakes. Snakes are perhaps the biggest threat to humans. A snake bite in the wilds of the Saline River bottoms can be an extremely painful experience, carrying with it severe illness, and in some cases, death.
Me and my brother were trot lining one night, and I was holding a light for him to get in the boat to crank the motor, because we had to go down this real slippery bank to get down there. And he got in the boat, and I was shining the light on the motor, and I hollered at him. Just by the time he stepped in the boat, I said, "Snake." And he just reached and grabbed it by the head and just throwed it out the boat like it wasn't nothing to it. And he sat down and cranked the motor. And I said, "Did you know what that was?" He said, "That was a snake." I said, "No, that was a cottonmouth." He said, "It was a cottonmouth." And he turned white as a sheet. And just, he couldn't do nothing for a little bit till he thought about it. But it was pretty scary, but he just chunked him out of there like a piece of trash.
While the sight of dangerous Saline River slithering snakes can make some turn white with fear, other rivermen tend to have a real knack for dealing with these fanged animals.
And one night, me and my uncle was seine in the river, and he's kind of crazy. He drank a pretty good bit, but we've seined up a net full of snakes, and he just folded the seine over to hold the snakes in the net, and it was like 20 of them in there. And he just jumped in the middle of them. He was mad. He jumped in the middle of them, went to kicking them out of the net with his feet. And he said, "They ain't gonna hurt you, they're water rattlers." I was scared of them. I wasn't about to get in them.
I came in one day. I love snakes. And this guy had given me what we call then a stinging snake, which didn't sting or anything, but he was red and black on his belly, and his tail came down to a fine point. Boy, I loved him. Of course, he was dead. I put him in a shoebox, came in the house, put him on the cabinet, and went on down the woods playing. When I got back up the house, my dad was standing there pulling his belt off when he saw me. And that was about the worst whipping I ever got. Because my mother, she had a phobia about snakes. She didn't even like to see them in a book.
Arkansas waters are home to 250 different types of fish, many of which are found in the Saline River. The Saline is home to an abundance of species including brim, crappie, bass, catfish, and gar.
Flatheads, blue cat, little fiddlers, a lot of those in there, drum, buffalo. I caught a fish one time, I didn't know what it was till later on in the years, but when I was a kid, I caught a walleye. And I had never seen one, I just didn't know what it was, and I threw it back. But it was pretty rare to catch a walleye in that river, but there are some in there.
The free-flowing nature of the Saline lends it to be the most natural river in all of the Ouachita Basin. Its fish are able to live freely in 100% open waters and are untouched by human technology other than bridges.
Brim is some of the best eating brim you ever get out of a river, Saline River. All the fish that comes out of there, good tasting fish. Mississippi tastes muddy, Ouachita tastes oily, so Saline River is the cleanest river around, really.
Just as the waters of the Saline are flowing full of life, the Saline River bottoms are teeming with wildlife as well. Probably one of the most prominent members of the Saline River bottom animal kingdom is the white-tailed deer. They gather their diet from legumes and other plants living wild in the river bottoms. These deer are popular among hunters, but can also provide some of the most scenic moments for people traveling down the Saline.
I remember we were videoing up around the old Benton crossing, the railroad crossing. And it was very narrow, but so far back that probably Jesus hadn't been back there in several months. But we saw a deer, a pregnant doe, jump about 50 yards ahead of us. So we pulled the motor right up beside her, and we had the video going, and we have videos of the deer swimming right beside the boat during our trip. And then when she hit the bank, it was just a steep bank. The old deer didn't even miss a, you know, she just went right up that bank like it was nothing.
The bottoms are full of other species including squirrels, otters, mink, beavers, muskrats, ducks, turkeys, as well as many different types of birds. All of these animals are essential to the circle of life in the Saline River bottoms, but one animal that is not native to North America and arrived in 1541 has spread rapidly in this region and can even be a major damager to local farms and plant life. Domesticated hogs were brought here to Arkansas with the Spanish army of Hernando de Soto in 1541. Naturally, many of these domesticated pigs got loose from the expedition and began thriving in the woodlands of Arkansas, including in the Saline River region. During the 1900s, after the Great Depression, these now feral hogs were trapped by locals and marked for ownership. They were, in fact, a terrific food source since hogs can reproduce at a very fast rate. 3 litters a year of sometimes 10 to 12 piglets can be birthed by one sow. But recently, with the decline in demand for feral hog meat, these animals are no longer claimed and used for their meat in the modern market. Therefore, they roam free with no check on their population growth, as no predator other than human hunters exists.
Yeah, well, when we were younger, everybody had a claim in the woods, so you didn't go down there and hunt hogs because everybody had their mark on their hogs, and of course a lot of feuds, you know, started over hogs. But one day, me and my brother were squirrel hunting, and I heard him shooting, and he kept shooting a lot. And so when I got down there, I heard him start hollering. And when I got down there, he was backed up against a tree. He was out of shells, and a group of hogs had him pinned up against a tree down there. And when I don't know whether they wasn't scared of him shooting at them, but when I started shooting from behind, they took off. So, but they was after him.
The largest land animal that lives in the bottoms of the Saline is the black bear. While they are fairly elusive and rare to ever spot, black bears are a solid symbol of the American wild. During the 1930s, a lack of conservation efforts left the black bear population in the state of Arkansas at fewer than 50. However, modern efforts have helped the black bear population to rise to around 3,000. You will likely never see a black bear without venturing into the deep, remote lands of the Saline, or in the Felsenthal Refuge, far away from highways and people. They eat wild berries and insects, and are most active in the early morning and late evening. One animal that prowls around the Saline River bottoms is not acknowledged by authorities as actually being in existence anywhere near the Saline, but black panthers have been heard and spotted by hunters and woodsmen around the river for decades. Anyone who has heard their goosebump-inducing night cry can attest to their existence, but others have actually seen them.
Well, basically, I was just squirrel hunting one day, and I was sitting there waiting on a squirrel to move up in the tree, and I caught something out of the corner of my eye, and I could tell it was black, whatever it was, and it was easing through the woods. It was two of them, and they was about half grown, and they had the tails was as long as their bodies, and they were just easing up through the woods, and I believe they was just two small, half-grown kittens, or whatever they call them. But I knew if they were there, then the mama was around. So I basically got on out of there.
The upper region of the Saline has been linked by historians with the Quapaw, or downstream people. Evidence found along its banks disputes this idea. Unearthed artifacts and excavated relics paint a picture of Caddoan civilizations living along the Saline. Several mounds have been discovered along its banks. Between what is today Benton and Hot Springs, a large ceremonial mound is located. Another mound is located near Benton. It is known as the Hughes Site. The Hughes Site is the only known late prehistoric mound center in the entire Saline River Basin north of Felsenthal, and was likely at the top of its period's hierarchy in the valley, being an important center for social and political power. It stands at 100 yards wide, 80 feet high, and 110 feet long. Other smaller mounds are scattered throughout the Saline River Basin. An especially large concentration of mounds is found in the extreme lower reaches of the Saline near present-day Felsenthal. In Bradley County alone, there are 140 confirmed pre-European camp, mound, and cemetery sites. These mounds are much smaller than the Hughes site and were probably used more for practical purposes than ceremonial burials, although some ceremonial mounds have been discovered in the same area. There are four mounds on Goulet Island in Ashley County that are approximately 2 feet high, probably seasonal campsites. One unique village mound is just a quarter of a mile west of the Saline River near present-day Warren, Arkansas. Without having a trained eye, it would be difficult to spot, since it stands just a few feet tall and is nestled in thick, mucky, forested land. The mound is around 300 yards by 300 yards in overall area. Its height suggests that it was a simple village site. Standing on average just about 5 feet above the surrounding land, this village site was probably seasonally inhabited and was built up to simply keep the people who lived here dry when the Saline flooded its banks and poured into the surrounding land. The Native Americans that lived here were hunter-gatherers and used the river as their highway. It was the quickest and most practical form of transportation. The natives would use something called a dugout canoe to travel up and down the waters of the Saline. Evidence has been found of dugout canoes being used on the Saline River as early as 1100 AD, although we can assume with little doubt that dugout canoes were being used here thousands of years earlier. But the best evidence we have for this form of transportation was discovered in the riverbank near Peeler Bend on the northern portion of the Saline in 1999. Charles Green found the 24-foot-long caddo canoe by accident. His discovery would prove to be perhaps the most important archaeological find ever in the Saline River region, if not one of the most important in the entire state of Arkansas. According to carbon dating to date, the dugout canoe is 1,024 years old. In the same year that the original yellow pine or bald cypress tree that the canoe was constructed out of started growing, Viking Leif Erikson, the first European ever to land in North America, was born. Meaning this tree began its life 580 years before Columbus sailed to the Americas. That makes this canoe the oldest watercraft ever found in Arkansas. Dugout canoes are simple, yet ingenious designs. They are made by cutting down a large tree and hollowing out the inner portion on one side by a combination of burning out and scraping with stone tools. Native Americans across the hemisphere used this method to create canoes for thousands of years. The presence of Native Americans can be seen beyond this canoe and the mounds that surround the Saline River. Arrowheads and other stone tools that were crafted by an ancient process called napping are a common find up and down the entire Saline River.
We spent a lot of time looking for arrowheads up and down the river, all the way up to the North Steel Bridge. Up and down the river, a lot of tremendous number of arrowheads. I never saw any actual Indian mounds, but evidently the Indians did an awful lot of hunting up and down that river. And we found a large number of arrowheads and other items, Indian items of all sizes, really. So it was quite an adventure for a young boy my age at that time.
One extremely rare spot on the Saline River is found north of Hudgeon Creek, east of Warren. Stretching across the entire river are a series of large stones that look as if they have been deliberately placed in a line. They appear to have been cut. Old-timers of the region will tell you that these giant rocks are not native to the lower portion of the river, and were in fact rafted downstream by Native Americans, possibly to act as a bridge. Today, they are only visible when the water is low, and no conclusive statement from archaeologist or geologist has been made as to what these rocks really are. The modern shape of Arkansas began to be created with the arrival of a new group of people into the region of the Saline. For thousands of years, the caddo had controlled the Saline River and hunted its lands. Now, a new wave of people would sweep across the river valley and forever alter the Saline. The North American Beaver. His wide paddle tail is his signature look. Building dams for protection against his predators is his main task in life. Swimming and roaming free in the Saline River bottoms, you wouldn't think much of this little fellow, but during the 1700s, the ancestors of this beaver altered history forever. At the time, A new fad was entering the fashion scene in Europe. Beaver felt hats. They required fur, and beaver fur was the most sought after in the world. Unlike the Spanish, who in search of gold murdered millions of Native Americans and left the land scarred with disease and death, the French arrived with a new philosophy: trade. The Saline River was home to this new American gold, the beaver, and therefore hundreds, if not thousands, of French fur trappers moved into the Saline Basin and set up camp. They would not attempt to overthrow the native powers, but instead partner with them in this new grand business of fur trapping. The French found a home here. Many of their families still live here to this day. As they brought with them their lust for beaver pelts, they needed an avenue to resupply while in the harsh wilderness of southern Arkansas. That brought men such as Peter Fogel to the region. Fogel arrived in 1790 at Longview and set up a trading post on the Ashley County side that supplied local French fur trappers. A small settlement popped up at Longview, which was the first on the lower Saline. As more and more French trappers and settlers arrived in the region, they began to name landmarks that had never before been called by European names. Today, we can still see their undeniable mark. Lagle Creek, meaning ill due to the creek's twisting nature. Darsal, originally Des Rousseau. Chemin Couvert, southernized into Smackover. Perigee and Goulet are all French names that have survived through to the modern world. Saline itself is also a French term. By 1819, when Arkansas was admitted to the Union, the Saline River Basin was a French and native world. You were more likely to hear someone speaking French than English, and the Saline was still the main means of transportation for the area. With the larger population beginning to settle in the area, supplying the people of the Saline region became a top priority. Canoes and flatboats would no longer be sufficiently fast enough to meet the demands and needs of the people.
Sometimes when I'm on the Saline walking around near dark or early morning when the fog's there, you can almost smell the torches from those old steamboats.
As time progressed and the United States began to take a larger grasp on life in Arkansas, life along the Saline River was set for revolution. For thousands of years, the people living along its banks had relied upon canoes for trade and transportation. Now, with modern innovation thrusting into the forefront, the times were changing. The first steamboat chugged its way up the Saline River around 1859, and again, forever altered the river's history.
Some 40-something steamboats came down the Saline. People would be surprised at that number generally. Now, they didn't run the Saline River all the time. They ran it during the months of October to March. Sometimes they would get stranded and have to plant a crop and wait for the water to come up next year before they could remove their vessels with higher water. And none of the vessels went any farther than Poole, which is Rising for us, Poole Landing at Rising.
Steamboats brought a wealth of new possibilities to a frontier that was bursting with growth. Some say that when the ships arrived in port, that their whistles could be heard for 30 miles. Perhaps a bit of an exaggeration, but nonetheless, people began to come out from the thick forest to buy their supplies, which had been shipped on the steamboats. These boats brought items such as blackstrap molasses, banana stalks and other fruits, pickled beef, sweets, and of course, liquor. The frontier families that came to shop when the steamboats arrived put on their finest clothes to come greet the adventurous ship crews that battled the wilds of the southern rivers. It was a chance to meet people who had ventured into the larger world and seen the great cities such as St. Louis and New Orleans. It was a chance to connect with someone who had experiences beyond the bottom land of the Saline River.
These old boats would go, as I said, from October to March when the high water was up. And they had these warehouses. One of the most popular warehouses was near Osmond Bluff at a place called G's Landing. Back when the Osmonds came to Osmond Bluff, they used the old boat that they came in as part of the old warehouse and lived in it while they were building their home. And at G's Landing, the Bella Darbonne was a famous boat, which there are pictures of that still around today. And the Bella Darbonne had a saloon on it. And they would honk the horns and the whistles, and they could hear for, they said, 10 miles down the river, you could hear it. And people would all come and buy their Christmas gifts and whiskey, and they could go to these old warehouses and buy their things. Out under Myrtle Tree, at the same location, was a cook on the Bella Darbonne who read people's fortunes by coffee grounds. So this was a time that these old ships were a lot of fun, a lot of good stories.
It was a common occurrence for some families to barter with chickens or other livestock rather than cash money for the items they needed. The ships would arrive with fresh supplies and would leave out again with new cargo. Staves for barrel making, cotton, and timber were among the items that the steamboats on the Saline shipped out of the region.
The Saline was considered during the Prohibition a back road, meaning it wasn't the White River, it wasn't the Arkansas, it wasn't the Mississippi, it wasn't even the Bartholomew. But it was a back road that was used often to take things that may have been military or secretive.
Being a crew member of a steamboat on the Saline was in itself a dangerous job. Not only could you potentially have to spend an entire summer along its banks if the water dropped out too early in the spring, but the life of a steamboat sailor carried its own hazards. Rogue logs hiding just beneath the water's surface could capsize the boat at any time. Fires could break out on board, and sometimes the cargo you were carrying could be not only hazardous, but illegal. One such event occurred just east of Warren on the Saline in 1913. A steamboat called the Gate City was illegally smuggling untaxed liquor when disaster struck.
And there was quite a stir on the Saline River. People would, right outside of Hot Springs, brew because of the water and the Saline River, a lot of moonshine stills. The Gate City was made in 1900 in Winona Shipbuilding. Then they sold it at Kentucky in 1906 to a guy by the name of Robbins had it, and he sold it to a Captain Armstrong, who owned it when it came through Warren. And they were going to Longview, probably would have stopped at Goins, which was also called Innis, I-N-I-S, that intermarried with the Goins family. Ennis Landing at one time it was called before Goins Landing. And they get about 3 miles from what we call the Warren Bridge between Warren and Monticello. And if you go back toward the North Bridge, you're gonna have shoals, and it's just, I mean, from the present day bridge back to this railroad bridge, it's almost impossible during the summer because there's nothing but shoals. And you have to walk the railroad tracks, which I've done. It's not any fun. And so then you get to this place, and they dug on both sides of the track when they built this trestle, and it's very deep there, even in shallow times. And so when it gets there, it was carrying some moonshine. This is in 1913, in October, the 15th of October, 1913. You say, well, Prohibition wasn't going on in 1913. Yes, but they had something called the navigation laws, which had just 2 months prior, in the same year, 1913, been incorporated, which said you could not transport by any vessel on water any moonshine, even before Prohibition. So they had gotten word that there was moonshine on some type of liquor on the Gate City. And they have these revenue men on this trestle. And it's coming from the north, going down to probably Goins, and then going down to the bigger place at Longview. And they're shooting at it, and for whatever reason, and it was a turning bridge back then, they shut it down where it could not turn, and they ended up getting confused, hit, whatever, and they went through the bridge, knocking down the boiler, catching a flame, and about 100 feet on this side, the Warren side, or the New Bridge side, it sank. Used to, you could see the boiler sticking out some 50 years ago. Many people have recorded seeing that. In low water, people would dive down. They got the whistle, which is used in one of the Warren lumber mills that we heard all of our life since 1913. I have a picture of that whistle. The mills have closed, but the whistle's still around. And they got several pieces off of the ship, including bottles. But no bottles had been found in a long time. And I made a trip down there the day after Memorial Day in 2012. Dove down and had another friend with me, and we researched, and one of the first things we found is very low water, but still that thing was pretty deep because of that hole they had dug in building the trestle. I found an old bottle, whiskey bottle, that in doing research, it had RNC4 on it. And it was the last one of those was made in 1904. And this was 1913. It was Reed and Company Bottling had made this whiskey bottle. Mr. Reynolds, who owned a company that did a lot of heavy equipment, who lives in the area across from what we used to call the Dairy Queen. And Sue Wagner lives in that house now. If you look on the back side of that house, there's a square about the size of an 8.5 by 11 piece of paper that's made out of some kind of garnished steel that came off of the Gate City. He uses his equipment. He was an equipment man. He used some of his equipment, got the boiler off and used it as a culvert in one of the deer camp roads that's locked down today. You can't get in there without permission, but if you look under one of those little roads, you'll find the old boiler there. The whistle was used for one of the mill whistles since 1913 that most of us in Warren heard all of our life. There's a lot of things about it that is very interesting. We only have one picture. It was taken in 1906 at the Winona shipyard.
Tragedies such as the Gate City were rare events. For many years, steamboat traffic on the Saline was heavy and provided a valuable service to local residents. The steamboat age, much like French fur trappers, left its own unique mark on the land around the Saline.
You know, there are 120 basic landings on the Saline River, 98 old ghost towns or villages, places that were named after families or unique events. Places like Slab City, where they had a stave factory and they used cross-cut saws, and Lick Skillet, or Lacey as it was called. Bull Bayou, where the Loveless family had butchered a bull and accidentally dropped it in the river at that spot. There's all kinds. My favorite would be Henderson, the area called Henderson Island, where a stave owner had drank moonshine all day and saw a vision at night of a white horse walking down the middle of the river, which to a riverman was a impending doom, manifestation of any kind of a white horse.
As more and more people moved into the region, roads were improved and more were constructed. But those roads stopped at the river. Bridges were as of yet not a common luxury in this region. If you needed to cross the Saline, you had two options. And most of the time, the water level made the decision for you.
There's been a number of ferries because about every neighborhood that was on the other side of the river, they need to come to town to sell things and also buy supplies. So they had to have a way of getting there. Of course, when the river was down, a lot of times on the Saline River, you could, what they call, ford the river, just drive across it. Water would be maybe a couple foot deep. But when it would begin to get rainfall and rise, they had to get on a ferry. And there was some type of little toll that the ferryman got. He certainly didn't get rich out of it, I'm told, but he got a little fee for looking after it, keeping it up.
A wooden flat-bottomed ferry capable of carrying a single wagon and team operated at this site from before 1842 until 1917. Lee's Ferry was a major crossing used by the stagecoach and mail service between Pine Bluff and Princeton. There were a number of ferries up and down the entire Saline. Nearly every community near the river had its own ferry, or at least one very close.
Mr. Coote Bradley was an elderly gentleman, and I'm not sure where he built the ferry, but he wound up in possession of the ferry. And they would always cross the river at what they call Coote's Ferry. And they'd come out by where we live and on up, and the road that comes out the highway, all the way out the highway where we now come out, didn't come out there at that time. It went on up and toward Franklin Creek and came into Highway 15, or now 63, near the Franklin Creek bridge crossing, just out of town here.
The site of Jenkins Ferry near Prattsville became the last organized Civil War battle in Arkansas in the spring of 1864, when Union General Frederick Steele, who was trying to cross the Saline River to return to Little Rock from Camden, was attacked by 10,000 Confederate soldiers. The Union troops managed to fight off the Confederates and escaped to the capital city. Other small skirmishes took place along the Saline. One of the last skirmishes took place near Longview. For years, treasure seekers have been searching the river for lost Civil War items, such as cannons and silver belt buckles that were hidden for safekeeping during the war and the skirmish.
A lot of people are still looking at Longview near the bridge, near the old ferry, for the cannons or the belt buckles, sterling silver belt buckles that were dumped in the river there during the Civil War. Truth is, they're not there. They were down at Horsehead Bend, about a fourth of a mile farther down. The three brother-in-laws, Captain Bob Withers, his brother-in-law Terrell, the third one, whichever, all of them had dumped these there at Horsehead and gone back after the war, and then took these and took the old self-made diving helmet. I think they made it out of an old tub with a air hose of some type, went down, got these sterling silver belt buckles, took them to New Orleans, made enough profit off of them that Terrell bought his store, that they bought the Morgan Nelson steamboat, which later used part of the Carey Poole steamboat. And the Carey Poole engine was used at the old sawmill there at Longview and run by the Bolin family.
Others have seen places along the river that show strong evidence of Civil War skirmishes, even upriver from Longview, that are not reported in any historical accounts.
I was walking down a ridge in the woods, and I kept seeing looked like clay roots were turned over, but I got to looking and they was all in a row down that one ridge. And after putting a little thought behind it, knowing there was a Civil War battle, I think they were foxholes where they had dug in along that ridge, because they were just in a line and it just looked like somebody dug a hole and piled dirt up in front of it. So I found that, and my uncle said they, when they were kids, that there was a cannon down there in the river. And said they used to play around it all the time, swim down there. And they said there was an old Civil War cannon down there, but I'd never seen it. But I'm pretty sure it was there. My uncle, he knew a lot about it down there.
My dad was a small logging contractor down through his years. And we went through World War II as a nation. And for a long time, we was working under what was known as the war economy. And then the war was over with, thank goodness. And then we went into a peacetime economy, and it took some transition for everybody to find their place in the workplace after then. And that put me at an age of about 10, 11 years old. And that's about 1947, 48. Mr. Melvin Holloway was an elderly gentleman out in our area there. In fact, he was our neighbor. And he had some sons that went off to war. And one in particular was some older than me by several years, but he was a favorite buddy because he would carry us boys down to the river fishing before we went into service. And we'd stay 2-3 days on the river down there, camped out, and eating and enjoying life. And of course, they'd done the work and we was doing the eating. That made life very interesting to us. But he left and went to the war and was overseas and received a severe injury to his leg and knee and had to go through a lot of surgery and recuperation to get back where he could get around. But he came home, and Mr. Holloway, as a young man, was involved with a group of other people of the area up and down the river, rafting logs. And that's a term, it's from the past. And they used the river for their railroad, if you will, to move the merchandise to the mills that was located downstream on farther down, even down into Louisiana, I'm told. And they would float those logs down the river on rafts, or in rafts, if you will. And the raft was put together by pinning a bunch of the heart pine and heart gum logs together that was floaters that would float. And they'd take the logs that they had questioned about being able to float and put them up on those and use the floaters to carry the sinkers. And they'd put together some big groups of logs, several thousand feet, sometimes several hundred thousand feet. And when the river would rise to a point to where it was the right level, they would put those logs in a river and pin them together with cables and different things that they used and form a raft. And everybody would join up in a partnership deal in a neighborhood. And this raft belonged to 3 or 4 guys or maybe 5 or 6 that had helped put them together. And they'd haul them down, bank them on the river with their mules and horses and wagons. And then when they get the rafts all fixed, they would load on and float down the river and be gone sometimes for several weeks till they got to their destination and got them sold, and they'd catch a train back. And that was that generated some yearly income for the family. But some of these rafts of logs, unfortunately, sank and went to the bottom. Mr. Holloway knew where some of those was. And as I mentioned earlier, the economy was a little bit slow. So my dad and some of his other logging friends decided that, having listened to Mr. Holloway's story about where those rafts of logs had went down, that they might could develop a market for those sunken logs. But that's what they were attempting to do, was get those logs out. My dad had some equipment, and he brought part of his logging crew in to help. And Mr. Holloway knew where these logs was that sunk these rafts, and he would go out with his John boat, and he had some called a pike pole. We called it a spike pole. It was a long handle, 10 or 12 foot long, made out of good wood, and had a sharp spike in the end of it, made out of steel. And he'd feel around and fish to where these logs were, and he'd stick that in there, and that would hold the boat in place. Jim, his son I mentioned earlier, was a great swimmer and was very capable of handling himself in that water and around that type of operation. He would just slide down the pole to where the logs was and feed his way around. Someone would lay down a set of tongs to him on a rope, and he'd hook into those logs. And they'd take the cable off one of those log loaders, and they had it sit on the bank behind some big trees and tie it down. And they'd go to pulling and tugging on that raft of logs until they broke it up and got some of them out. And then the rest of them wasn't near as hard to get hold of because they had been given some slack.
After they retrieved the logs, they cut the ends off using crosscut saws. What they discovered was that the wood, after being submerged for years, had developed unique and beautiful characteristics, a process that only nature could perfect.
I was there when they pulled them up out of the water, and maybe not every day, because some days I had assignments at home I had to take care of, but every day that I could go down there, I wanted to be there. Too much excitement to miss. They would take a crosscut saw, and remember, in that day, there wasn't any chainsaws, it was crosscuts. Saw had a handle on each end of it, and the man get on each end, and they'd cut off 6 or 8 inches of log to see what it looked like. Some of the most beautiful woods you ever laid your eyes on in those logs, especially the we call it sweet gum species of wood. But after they get old, they will turn red-hearted, or some of the time people call them figure-hearted, because in the texture of the grain, the grain wouldn't necessarily look like it's running straight. It would have an odd grain arrangement in it, and that's where the word figure-hearted come from. But the mineral, I don't know exactly what the chemistry on this would be, but the water carrying certain minerals down, soaking in there, would cause this wood to change colors. And I wouldn't say texture, but especially change colors. Some of the most beautiful colored woods you ever laid your eyes on.
The world of the Saline River bottoms was lighting up with the excitement of underwater logging. As the young boys watched the elder woodsmen work in the heat of the day to help make a living, another bright side of life on the Saline continued for these young men, just as it had for the Frenchmen of the 1700s, and even the Caddo who once inhabited this land.
As a young boy or lad of 10 or 12 years old, I was interested in excitement of what was going on. And of course, when noon comes, someone had caught some fish, and we all had big fish fry, and all the things that goes with that.
Frying fish was as much of a tradition on the Saline River as the sun rising in the east every morning was. For these families that lived near the river, a fish fry was a way of life, and one that seemed to bring entire communities together. It was an exciting time, and a unique place to live. Some of the greatest fish cooks in the world developed their craft right next to the Saline. The method of a mass fish fry was passed down to the younger generations right alongside the pastime of fishing. The sides that went along were age-old recipes that have mostly survived to today, and the equipment and ingredients used still are embossed on the minds of those who took part.
A wash pot, some may not be familiar with what I'm talking about. It's a round cast iron vessel, and some of those things will hold probably 8 or 10 gallons of liquid. And of course they didn't put that much in there, but everything is tapered to the bottom, and you can cook you can have a half a pot of fish if you want to do it, or you can have a whole pot of, but they clean those fish down there on the river, and then have a fire, everything with wood heat, wasn't no butane carried down there. And somebody had to go get the wood up. That's where we boys fit in real good. They go out and get the woods located. We'd arm it up and bring it up, stack it up there on the campground. And build a fire and heat that grease up. And they would cook those fish, fry them. And someone would go by the local store and get a bunch of brown paper bags. I remember that distinctly. They tear them open, lay them down. Fish went on that, and the paper would absorb the excess oil and grease. And of course, if you're catching, depends upon what variety of fish you're catching or species you're catching, someone has to know how to cut those fish up right where they are, can be eaten. And there was always some old timers around that knew just exactly how to do that. It's one of the things, you boys get around here and show you how to do this. One of these days, you know, y'all be the ones having to do this, we'll be gone. Well, that day is today, because here I am at soon be 76 years old, and that's probably the age that most of them was, and some younger, when they was teaching us how to do this. I didn't learn my lesson as well as I should have, but I can get by. But anyhow, they would cook those fish, and of course, some of the staples that you carried with you would be plenty of Irish potatoes and onions and beans, pork and beans a lot of times. That'd be bought from the store. But those Irish potatoes would be brought from home. You peel them, wash them, cut them up, make your, and fry your potatoes.
Life on the river wasn't all about cooking fish. Mr. Hollis Clanton grew up at Moore's Mill on the lower end of the Saline River without modern conveniences, such as electricity. His family put their milk in one of the cold freshwater springs that feeds into the river in the days before they had a refrigerator. The river even played an important role in the spiritual life up and down its banks. Many have been baptized in the Saline.
He said, if it's good enough for Jesus, good enough for me. My husband was Johnny Jones, and he pastored the first Free Will Baptist Church here in Warren. Then we ended up at Harmony for 10 years. That's out in Rye, what they call Ignorant Bend. And then we went to Faith, organized that church, and we were there for 18 years. We got saved after we got married, and it was in February. And everybody thought you ought to go right then. So they didn't have baptistries in the tiny little church where we were saved, so we went to Natural Dam up on the other side of Van Buren. And there was actually ice around the edges, and we were baptized then. So that's where it got instilled in us. I was terrified of water, just terrified of water. And Johnny told me, it'll be okay, I'll hold your hand, because I trusted him, you know. He had been a lifeguard in the Hawaii Ocean and had, you know, Red Cross training, so I totally trusted him. But I was terrified. And being a new Christian, I didn't know to ask much about what I should wear. But back then, you didn't wear pants. So I found out you're supposed to take a safety pin and you pin your skirt between so that it won't float up. Nobody told me not to wear a light color, but they were there waiting on me when I came out. But it was such a special thing. It was just like I could just visualize because I always had known about Jesus being baptized in the river. But, you know, it just, that's all I did know, is just that he had been, but I didn't know what it meant and how you would feel. And it's just a special feeling. It's like chills come over you, and then you just, you feel like you're so excited and so happy that you're following the commandment. And, or the, you know, to be back, go ye and preach unto all nations and be baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. And I really didn't know at that time, being a new Christian, just what it would entail. But it was an experience, very special also, because my husband was with me. So it was just an amazing experience, and I'll never forget it. It just, a lot of people, we felt the experience and had the desire to go be baptized in the water, because that's the way Jesus did it. We did a lot of baptisms at the, is it the North Steel on the Pine Bluff Highway? And when you would get there in the afternoon, there would be a lot of people fishing, a lot of people partying, and those sorts of things. But they were always very respectful, and they would, you know, quieten down, and a lot of them observed, you know, because it was something they'd never seen. And but that's where we would go. And any time of the year, it just didn't get too cold. First, Johnny goes into the water, leading whoever. And if there's a person that's really tall, really large, usually a deacon would go out. But Johnny always led. They held hands as they went out into the water. And then he would baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. He didn't do like a lot of people, a lot of ministers would wear hip waders, you know, and that kind of thing to keep dry. He would wear, he had real sensitive feet, so he would wear like a pair of tennis shoes. In fact, we had a pair that we called his baptismal shoes. And then he would wear just like some khaki pants and a, you know, a shirt. And that was it. And then he usually would not take a towel or anything else. He just, you know, a lot of, you know, people that were being baptized, especially the women, when they came out, they wanted to, you know, have to be covered, because sometimes the clothes are, you know, a little revealing, and you don't think about that when you're going to go.
Over the years, the river has been used as a symbol of the washing away of sin. It can be an extremely emotional experience that many feel gets them closer to God in a way that nothing else can.
It's just so special. The only way you know is if you do go through. That's it. That's the only way you'll know. But to me, you have to have a really humble spirit, and you just don't care if your hair's wet and you look ugly and your clothes are wet. You just don't even think about that, you know. And I was always so particular about how I looked, you know. And I was just like, man, how am I going to handle this with my hair being all wet and everything? But it didn't matter.
Not only was the river a place for redemption, it was just plain fun.
My parents had a camp down at Longview, and we would go down. It was a gravel road, and we would ride down, and I still remember topping the hill at Longview and looking out and seeing that beautiful expanse of pasture, and then going down to our camp was right at the bottom of the hill. And I remember learning to brimfish was my first recollection. I learned to brimfish on the river, and I actually learned how to fly fish down there too. My dad would paddle the boat and was very kind, I think, and very patient with somebody young to teach him how to fly fish.
Well, we had a 49 Army bus we took down there, and I actually drove it down in there. It
actually would run. And we parked it down there, and we fished in it, or fished out of it for a long time, camped in it. We were sitting there one day, and we was all sitting around there talking, and by the time we looked up there, we had a sink up there, and this big rat, as big as a squirrel, run up on this sink and was just stood up on his hind legs and was just looking around like, what are y'all doing in my bus? Well, my cousin Doug was in the back, and I was sitting up close here, and we had a wood pile in there. Well, I grabbed a stick of wood and hit the rat, but it hit the wall, and he went over and hit Doug in the head, cut his head, but we got the rat. And then there was another school bus down there my daddy and uncles put down there, and Gerald Calhoun was in there, and they was fixing to go to bed. And at the time, we heard some guns going off in there, and he done found a snake. He shot the bottom of the bus up trying to kill a snake, and he slept in a tent from then on. He wouldn't go in that bus.
We moved to Monticello from Strong when I was about 6 or 7 years old, and I guess as I became, after I learned to drive at about 13, the river became a real favorite place for me. Fishing, swimming, swinging out on the old tire swing and letting go, that kind of stuff.
One place along the river that evokes memories of a time far gone is Camp Mansfield. The camp began as a vision of Mr. R.L. Newton, who wanted a site for a summer YMCA camp. He shared his vision with Lawrence Hurley, who approached the Fullerton brothers, Robert W. and S. Baker, about donating some of the Bradley Lumber Company land as a site for this camp. Mr. Hurley then approached the Arkansas Lumber Company, asking them to build the camp. After the two-story building was completed in the 1920s, it was named after Clifford J. Mansfield, the vice president and general manager of the Arkansas Lumber Company. The YMCA held summer camps at Camp Mansfield for almost 40 years.
Yeah, it was Camp Mansfield, and 60 years ago, this year, as a matter of fact, Mr. Hugh McInnes hired me to sweep up, clean up, polish the furniture at the YMCA. I later became a lifeguard through the Red Cross lifeguard program, and then a water safety instructor. So I went to Camp Mansfield both as an attendee, if you will, 1 year, and then another year as a counselor, and then another year as a lifeguard and counselor.
The campers who spent time at Camp Mansfield were treated to a taste of life on the Saline River for a week at a time. It was a chance for these young men to learn about and experience the wilderness firsthand, discover new hobbies and talents, as well as bond with their peers.
Most of my class, John Frazier, Dale Nicholson, Dale Pope, Jimmy Neely, Donald Reger, we had Joe Mullins, spent some time there as a scout, but I don't think he ever attended one of the camps. Woody and Rudy Jolly were younger boys at that time, and they were there. Probably Ronnie McFarlane, and I don't know about Ronnie Higgins, but he was in the age group, so just about everybody went to Camp Mansfield at one time in their life.
Well, we went on Monday, and I think we came back on Friday. The Bradley store sent a truck down to the Y to pick us up and carry us out there. And then we went to, we went to the old highway and turned down in front of Rex's. It was a two-story building. We had a two-story building. You walk in the door, on the right would be your kitchen, on the left would be the mess hall. And go up the steps, and that's just one big room full of cots, and that's where we slept.
We learned a lot of the wood lore skills, if you will, trapping animals, making snares, a tremendous amount of time in the water, swimming and fishing and boating. And we had a spring there. I guess it's still there. I haven't been back to that area since I've been back here in Warring. but I'm sure that spring is still there. Some of the best water you've ever seen.
While the days were filled with hikes, trapping, and swimming, the favorite activity for most everyone was fishing. The young men spent hours on end just floating down the river catching panfish left and right.
Oh, absolutely. Fishing and up and down the banks, fly fishing in particular. We would take a truck inner tube and tie all of our lures onto that inner tube with a little water to drink along the way, and get in the middle and walk up and down the river and float when you needed to, and fly fish both sides. Even the smallest bream, bream is mostly what you would catch, but it's just a really good feeling to get that bream on the end of that line. You get a good fight and bring him in. And that's mostly what we call fly fishing, but it's still today, I'm sure, very good fly fishing.
With the day's catch hauled in and the sun going beneath the western horizon, the whole gang gathered each night around a huge campfire beside the river.
And at night it was particularly good because we had a large bonfire, if you will, out in front of the building, quite a ways away from the building, a large fire. And we had logs all around that fire. And at night we would gather there and sing songs, Kumbaya and all those type songs and hymns and other campfire type songs. And that was before I knew that I couldn't sing, so I always sang at those things. And we were there one year and we rigged up something for the fire. They probably wouldn't let us do that today. But we had a big fire in the circle with the logs all the way around the middle of the fire pit. And we put a piece of wire from the center of that fire pit up to almost the top of another tree. Thin wire that you couldn't see. And we had dipped that rag in some type of kerosene or something. I don't remember what we dipped it in, but flammable. So that after it got dark and we had everybody in place, and we did a prayer and you lifted up your head, and all of a sudden here comes the fire from the heavens, and it just blows, makes the fire just explode, it seems like. Not dangerous, but it was a lot of fun. And it was really quite an event. Sometimes we looked at the stars and we had people who really knew the heavens quite well, and they would explain, you know, what the different stars, and it was just a very good time in my life.
We sit around and talk, and some of them try to sing, but I can't hear a tune very well, so I just listen.
As the group of boys hung out around the campfire each night, surrounded by the dark and eerie Saline River bottoms, it was inevitable that a ghost story or two found its way into the conversations.
A tremendous amount of ghost stories, and really some of the younger kids could get quite excited with those stories. We had some good ghost stories.
Ghost stories led to excited and scared young men, which again led to the inevitable, pranks.
I'm sure it was. Of course, I wouldn't have anything to do with that.
After a long day of swimming, fishing, ghost stories, and pranks, no one had any trouble going to sleep. Unless they forgot their mosquito net, that is.
Night, they told me to carry mosquito nets while you're sleeping. And I didn't carry the mosquito net. And the mosquitoes gave me a hard time.
Later generations, such as Boy Scouts, utilized the Saline for learning outdoor skills and bonding as well.
Oh, we had a Boy Scout. We had a guy named Bob Kane, who was the scout leader. He was a forester for Potlatch, and I can't believe he did this, but he took about 20 young boys, aged 12 and 13, on a four-day canoe trip down the Saline River. And we just drove him crazy. He was the only guy with all those, only adult with all those boys. But he taught us how to camp and spend the night out. And the second day in, I got too much sun, and They had to put me out. They were going on down below Longview, but they had to put me out in Longview. I remember lying in the front of that canoe all day long, just thinking I was going to die, and just couldn't wait to get home. On the way back into town, those guys decided that they had a dozen eggs left, and we're in the back of the truck, and they started egging the cars coming the other way. And they got, fortunately for me, I was at home, I wasn't involved in all that, but I'm sure I'd have been right in the middle of it, but they got in a heap of trouble for throwing eggs at cars. And Bob Kane said, oh, my boys wouldn't do that, but sure enough, his boys had done that. But yeah, it was just, the Saline River is just a wonderful stream. And even today, it hadn't changed any. It's just great, and it's not dredged, and so it's great for fishing. Longview's wide enough that you can put a little bit bigger boat in that area, and actually use party barges down there. It's changed dramatically too. It stayed the same, the river, but it's changed because all the houses, the second homes people have built on it, it's really actually developed in some areas.
The Saline River was a place not only for YMCA summer camps and Boy Scouts, but a place for families. Generations of fathers and sons have passed down age-old traditions over the years. These memories of time spent with one's father is something priceless. Brian Martin remembers his time on the Saline with his dad with great fondness.
He grew up and spent his entire life in fishing and hunting down in, that was called Martin Bottoms. And of course that had a lot of beautiful timber in that area, and that's obviously where he liked to hunt and fish, so that's why he brought his son up to play there. He and Dr. Hugh Mosley, a guy named B.B. Paulus, Joe Reeves, and W.D. Roddy all shared in a one-room camp house with an outhouse. That was my first experience with an outhouse, and it was a two-holer. And well, it was just really interesting to go out there. My sisters would have to go out to the outhouse, and we would throw pine cones and things and try to disturb them, I think, while they were in there. So it was really a unique experience for me. I learned a squirrel hunt down there, and as a teenager, our parents turned us loose because they felt like we could play down there without damaging anything and without getting in trouble. So we had a group of us that after every football game during the Mickey O'Quinn era, we would finish the football game and load up in a car, and we called ourselves the River Rats, and we would go spend the Friday night down after the ball game down at that camp. And on Saturday, we'd get up and play and just mess around all day like teenage boys. But we found an old chest of drawers, and we tore the drawer facings off and put a nailed tennis shoes to the face of the drawers. And then we got two flat-bottom John boats with 10-horse motors on them, got some old telephone wire and tied them to the back of the boat and to a broken boat paddle. And that was our ski rope. And of course, there were no rudders on the bottom of those drawer facings. And also, the boats weren't fast enough to pull you up out of the water. So we would sit on the edge of the boat dock, watch the curled up wire, and then when the wire would get taut, we'd just stand up and ski behind those two boats. We had them tied together. And that's where we learned to water ski. And of course, there were no rudders on those drawer facings, and you just slide all around. And generally, we would do it like idiots in the early late fall, and water would be cold, and the fishermen hated us because we were making big ripples. It was great fun. I have fond memories of that bunch of guys, and still in contact with some of them. One of them, they were names that people around here wouldn't be familiar with, but one of them was Bill Sharp and Rich Anthony and David Roddy and Dr. Crow's son, Jim Crow. We were all, and John Lowry, we were the River Rats. We thought we were really something, which maybe we were for Longview in the Saline River. And that's one of the memories I have. We tried to learn to cook a rabbit down there one night. That was a lot of fun. And then we would also stay up late. We thought we were really doing something, stay up past midnight, and we'd roam up and down that gravel road, but we never did anything damaging or hurt anybody, and didn't hurt ourselves, fortunately. We'd ride on the front of Rich Anthony's Ford, his mother's car, put two guys on the front with 22s and go down Earl Reynolds' farm, go through his farm, shooting at rabbits. And we captured one night and cooked it, but it was horrible. And that's my last taste of rabbit. I won't be back.
The Saline River is also a sportsman's paradise, with what some say is the best fishing in the world. And every lifelong fisherman can recall a great story from the river.
Well, my uncles, of course, they's all pretty good yarn tellers. But anyway, one night my uncle Jake said that they hung this fish down there on the river. And it was so big it broke the line, a trot line. Well, he held on to the line and it pulled him down the river. And he said, I don't know what it is, but it's big. And they got to Hog Shoals, and he told his brother, he said, we got him now, because we coming to Hog Shoals, and he can't get through them shoals, it's so shallow. So when he got to the shoals, Uncle Jake said, he run out on the bank and run up the bank. And he said, get the dogs, and we put the dogs on him. And he chased him up and down through the woods for a while, and they run him up a tree. And he said, get the light and we'll see what it is. Well, by the time he got the light, it flew out of the tree.
One of the most plentiful animals on the Saline River are freshwater mussels. Mussels are bottom-dwelling, and they can number more than 100 per square yard. Mussels are interesting organisms. They are made up of a hard outer shell, a soft inner body called the meat, and 1 foot used for slight maneuvering in the river. Native Americans used mussels on the river as an easily obtainable quick food source. They are a terrific indication of the health of an environment. Since they feed by taking in water that flows amongst them, their populations can help indicate the magnitude of pollution in a waterway. The Saline contains several species of mussels that are in need of environmental protection, but others are extremely plentiful and have even contributed to a new unique business, mussel jewelry. Zach McClendon founded Saline River Diamonds not long ago after coming up with a method of turning these oftentimes beautiful shells into jewelry.
My kids and myself are all kind of into nature. We love nature, and my daughter bought a cabin on the Saline River by the old worn road bridge. And she just loves it. She loves the river, she loves wildlife, and I try to make things for my kids for Christmas rather than buy something. I try to make them or paint them something. And I thought, well, I'll make her a necklace out of gravel. So I went down there and got some gravel, and then in the process of getting gravel, I picked up a few shells, and gravel didn't work out. I tried polishing it, and I tried drilling it, and it was just too hard. And then I started playing around with the shells, and I had to go back and get some more shells, but ended up making her a necklace and earrings out of mussel shells. And as she wore them around, she was thrilled to death, you know, come out of the Saline River. And as she wore these around town, well, people would comment to her about how, you know, they look good and how nice they look. And she would tell me about this, so I thought, well, I'm gonna make some more of these. And I did, and then people wanted to buy them, and so I started making more, and set up Seasons in Monticello as a dealer to sell them, and they have sold a lot of jewelry. And now I have a rep that covers Arkansas, Texas, and Oklahoma, and part of Louisiana, and he calls on gift shops, jewelry people, and So we're growing as a little bit. We started out primarily when we started marketing it with earrings, even though I'd made a necklace for my daughter. And then the next thing we made was a bracelet. And the next thing was necklaces for sale. And we only use sterling silver. It's all silver. The basic colors are white, which comes out of a muscle called a washboard. And then we have a kind of a purple mauve color. And then we have a pink. And now we've learned to process them into a brown and black that we call a tortoiseshell look. It is a process, and it developed over a period of time. I mean, the first time I tried it, well, it didn't work. So I kept playing around trying other things, and gradually developed a full process of polishing and putting them through an acid bath. And there is a process, and I really don't tell anyone the whole story because it's kind of a guarded secret.
From muscle jewelry to fabulous fishing, and a rich history on top of that, the Saline River has given so much to the people who have inhabited its surrounding lands over the years. The Saline comes to an end when it enters the Ouachita River in Felsenthal, one of the lowest places in all of Arkansas geographically.
Felsenthal is a wonderful, wonderful thing in my view. It's you can see timber there that you won't find in Bradley County anymore. It's been, you know, the saws are no longer, you know, can't operate in there. And it's just pristine, beautiful, timbered country. It's great.
The river, in its own unique way, travels from the Ouachita Mountains as a traditionally mountain-dwelling stream, winds its way through the West Gulf Coastal Plain as a gravel-bottom river, and ends its journey looking more like a large delta bayou. The Saline breaks off into a large marshland in Felsenthal. The many fingers of the slough eventually end up merging with the Ouachita River a little further south. The water that doesn't break off into the slough turns west and becomes a much wider river just a few hundred yards before it finally enters the Ouachita. The Saline that flows beside our communities today carries with it a distinction that places it among the most natural of natural sites in Arkansas, the natural state. It is the last free-flowing river in the entire Ouachita Basin. No dams exist along its 204-mile journey. It provides us with a special look into the wilderness when left untouched by modern machinery. But over the past 200 years, the Saline has faced the major threat of losing its free-flowing status. Several groups have proposed dams along its route, and even the government has come close at times to making the huge mistake of attempting to tame this great river. The first proposals to dam the Saline came as a result of a flood on another river. The Great Mississippi Flood of 1927 hit the United States hard. 27,000 square miles of land across the Mississippi Valley were completely covered by water, and by May of that year, the Mississippi River reached a width of 60 miles. Arkansas was the hardest hit of the 10 states affected, with 14% of its land totally underwater. The Saline River was not spared from this flood either, as the Ouachita River rose rapidly and backed up the Saline.
In 1927, probably the greatest flood in all-time history that wreaked all kind of humanitarian chaos and discomfort and relocation and everything, 1927, that flood. Subsequent to that time, the Congress and the people, I don't want to say overreacted, but they reacted in such a way that they wanted to start building dams everywhere to control not necessarily the water supply, but the water flow, especially during the periods in the spring and of heavy rains, et cetera, and when the rivers would swell and flood over their banks. So the flood of 27 really kicked off this enormous wave of legislation to empower the Corps of Engineers to go out and dam all of these free-flowing streams everywhere.
After the Great Flood of 1927, the Flood Control Act of 1937 was proposed in Congress. It would have dammed every major stream in the Ouachita Basin. Initially, the Corps of Engineers planned an earthen dam on the Saline that would generate hydroelectric power. Elected officials in several counties came out against the proposed dam, and only a small amount of support came from residents of Benton, who believed it could provide a water source and more recreation opportunities for their area. In 1973, the Corps of Engineers were asked by then-Governor Dell Bumpers to restudy the feasibility of the dam due to what was seen as a long-term need for water in the central part of Arkansas. Sometime later that year, the Little Rock Water Department officially stated the city of Little Rock had no need for any water generated from the new dam. However, the fight was far from over. Residents in the Benton area continued to voice their wishes for the construction of the dam on the upper portion of the river.
At that time, a governor had veto authority over a Corps of Engineer project like this. And so I don't think I ever got to the point of exercising a veto, nor can I find a letter that I wrote to the Corps saying, don't dam up the Saline River. But I think it was just in meetings and by osmosis, people on both sides just gathered that this was not a good idea, and that a governor was opposed to it, and if a governor was opposed to it, in all likelihood, it would never go from blueprint stage to reality. I pretty well squelched the idea of building a dam.
With Governor David Pryor voicing his sincere disapproval for any dam on the river, it looked as if the fate of the Saline as a free-flowing river had been sealed for good. But during the late 1980s, residents of Benton once again brought the issue back to the surface.
The people up around the Benton area, the water, public water system, can't remember exactly what they're called, but it was the public water system for the area around Benton, that they wanted to dam up the river up on the north end. Of course, this had been talked about many times over the years, but it cropped up again. And the purpose was to create a water supply for Benton and that part of Arkansas. Well, obviously, we were very concerned because you can imagine if we experienced the river being dammed up on the north end, if anything, it was going to create an even more severe low flow condition during certain times of the year down our way. So there were some public hearings held concerning the possibility of damming the river, and as mayor, I attended one of those meetings and got up and voiced the city of Warren's concern about damming the Saline River. We were against it for a number of reasons, but as mayor, I would certainly do everything I could to make sure that did not take place. I felt like the city council was behind me on that, but I really spoke for myself as mayor. Wasn't too much longer, just really a few days after that a lawsuit was filed in state courts up in the Benton area. And I don't remember all the details of who all they filed the suit against, but they included the city of Warren and me as the mayor of Warren. Now, obviously what they were trying to do was to get a judge to rule that they had a right to build the dam, because the people that were trying to get the dam built had already started running into a lot of problems with the environmental laws and the agencies of both the state and the federal government, and they thought if they could get a court to rule in their favor, then they could go forward with their plans to dam up the Saline River. So ended up having to fight that lawsuit, and the good news is it got dismissed. We won. Certainly we're not forced to do anything new, and the whole issue of damming the river ultimately died.
today, due to the wise foresight of many men and women of past generations, the Saline remains free-flowing.
To ever dam it up would just be a crime, I think.
Keep it free-flowing and leave it alone. God will take care of it. For future generations, it'd be great if you could almost turn it into a national river like the Buffalo National River. It'd be great to protect it like that stream.
We didn't make it natural. God made it natural. It's our duty to keep it this way. And all we've got to do is just keep it as it is, as we found it, and as we've got to preserve it. And it's not all that complicated. We can find ways to feed our families and clothe our children and whatever in other ways than by destroying the environment. Arkansas has a great name of being a natural state, and now it's up to all of us to realize that this is a trust that we hold, and for future generations. We're trustees, basically, is what we are, and we've got to realize that on a daily basis.